please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
Okay, let's start off with seeing what are things that are happening in the global arena. Global bankers and finance ministers from around the world have gathered at Jackson Hole, Wyoming in the United States for the annual Economic Policy Symposium. Now, speaking at the gathering, in his first address at the summit, Fed Chairman Jerome Powell said he expects to see further interest rate increases ahead. Now, according to him, the economy is strong and can handle more normalization of the policy. So far this year, the US Federal Reserve has hiked rates 2 times, and the members of the Federal Open Market Committee have indicated that 2 more rate hikes might be coming. And on Wall Street, US stocks rose in overnight session, with the S&P 500 and the Nasdaq closing at record highs after Federal Reserve Chairman Jerome Powell affirmed the central bank's strategy of gradually normalizing monetary policy. The S&P 500 rose over 0.5%, led by gains in materials as well as tech stocks, while the Nasdaq advanced almost 1%. Dow as well jumped around 133 points at close. And in terms of the data that we were expecting, weekly jobless claims fell to 210,000 year levels, not seen since 1969. And core durable goods orders rose 1.4% in July as well. Well, leverage asset prices and rising rates is not a great combination, says Raghuram Rajan. Speaking to CNBC TV18's Steve Leisman from the sidelines of the Jackson Hole Summit, he talks about the Fed's rate trajectory and what he makes of the growth in the emerging markets. Here's a slice of that interesting conversation.
He did mention that the Fed was on the lookout for that. I do worry that in this period of accommodation, we've had an increase in leverage, not in the same places as before, in new places. Mm-hmm. Of course, the emerging markets, but also the corporate sector in the United States. And leverage plus asset prices plus rising interest rates, that's not a great combination.
Given all of that, would you be steering the Fed the way Chairman Powell is steering it, with gradual rate hikes, or do you think there's a need to remove accommodation and liquidity faster?
No, I think, as he said, you're sort of steering between two pitfalls. One is going too fast and tanking the economy, and the other is going too slow and raising questions about whether you were at the right pace, and then suddenly people think you're going to go faster, which is equally problematic. I think they're doing a reasonable job of advertising what they're going to do, but also doing it and not backing off as a result of market volatility and so on. I think if it gets big, and I think he hinted at that, they may reconsider, but at this point, they're moving at this pace.
One of the fallouts from higher interest rates has been some disruption. Maybe that's too kind a term, but trouble in some emerging markets. Turkey is one particular example that's been out there. Is that a unique case, or is that the sign of things to come in some of these emerging market countries as a result of an appreciating dollar and a higher Fed funds rate?
Well, I don't think it's unique, but I do think it's an outlier that Turkey has had some pretty significant buildup in corporate debt, especially foreign exchange denominated. And Turkey has also had some bad policies, including the idea that inflation is controlled by keeping interest rates low rather than raising them. And I think as a result, that has upset markets, and Turkey has suffered some of those consequences. Of course, Argentina was before Turkey. Argentina did many of the right things, but did them a little slowly, and the markets again lost patience. I think there are other countries which have problems of large current account deficits, large fiscal deficits, and possibly political change. And they will have to react when the time comes in a way to reassure markets. But in some sense, I think we hope that these two countries are outliers, not an
indication. How about India? Is India something that creates concern for you?
No,
context?
I think broadly India has had reasonable macro policy over the last few years. I think there have been some aberrations, like the demonetization, mm-hmm. which slowed growth considerably. Growth is picking up right now. And, you know, India has reserves, 400 billion plus. So it's in a much better position than it was in 2013.
Okay, so India is in a much better position than it was in 2013. But as India's trade deficit widens, many economists have revised higher their current account deficit targets for the current year from around 2% of GDP earlier to 3% of GDP. Here is what Sonal Verma of Nomura and Sajid Chinoy of JP Morgan had to say on the subject.
We need to differentiate between the here and now problem and the five-year problem. The here and now problem is basically we need to, you know, narrow the current account deficit, and we need measures to basically boost our net capital inflow so that the balance of payment funding for this year basically happens. The five-year problem is that, you know, we keep getting back into this problem where you have some real currency depreciation, you know, the trade imbalance is correct, you know, imports come down, exports go up a bit, and then over a period of time, we go back to a scenario where we are again importing a lot of electronics, a lot of capital goods. Even when there is a global export upcycle, we are not able to participate because we are not present in a lot of categories in the global markets.
Our macro fundamentals are very sound. Inflation is half the level it was in 2013. India's reserves are 1.5 times what they were in 2013. And even though the current account is, you know, widening to 3%, it's nowhere near the 5% it was. So by all measures, if we compare ourselves to other emerging market current account deficit countries, we're much better, and investors will make that differentiation. What should we do? Two things. I think a calibrated, gradual, non-disruptive depreciation is what the doctor calls for, which will help these external imbalances. Ultimately, the current account is simply investment minus savings. We don't want to contain investment. We need higher investment. So what we want to do is boost savings.
Welcome back. Well, sources say initial plan to roll out FAME II subsidies only for buses has been reviewed. Parikshit Luthra joins in with more details. Parikshit, good afternoon. Thank you so much for joining us. Tell us, what are the key changes and recommendations that have been made in this review now?
Well, earlier when an interministerial panel had decided on FAME subsidy part 2, they had decided that the subsidy should only be for buses and for public transport, because they felt that when it comes to private vehicles, scooters, three-wheelers, and also for four-wheelers, it won't be possible for the government to give subsidy in such large numbers over a prolonged period of time. But now we believe there has been a review of the earlier decision, and this latest decision has been spearheaded by the Heavy Industries Ministry and also the Department of Expenditure, and they've decided to put a certain amount of money in this 5,500 crore subsidy for electric vehicles apart from buses. So if you have two-wheelers, if you have three-wheelers, if you have four-wheelers, they too will get a subsidy, but that subsidy will only be about 1,500 crore rupees over a period of 5 years. This, many industry experts say, is very low, will not be enough, but it seems that the government is trying to placate the industry, which was really upset with the fact that they will have to tweak their norms. They will really have to press the pedal, and they will have to take the entire burden of moving to electric vehicles. This announcement, we believe, will be made at the Mobility Summit, which will be held on the 7th and 8th of September in New Delhi. Back to you.
Okay, Parikshit, thank you so much for getting us the latest on that. But let's move on. It's been a year since the Supreme Court's landmark judgment upholding privacy as a fundamental right. But privacy is still a work in progress, says the CEO of the Unique Identification Authority, who also added that the government remains keen on a data protection law. Now, speaking exclusively to CNBC TV18's Ashmit Kumar, he also argued for data localization, claiming that it will spur innovation as well as growth. And finally, UIDAI CEO also made a plea to all the users not to share their Aadhaar numbers on social media.
We issued an advisory saying that the people should not put their personal information, such as Aadhaar, unnecessarily on a social media or social domain. And I'll give you an example. You use your debit card, credit card, PAN card everywhere, right? And you share with wherever you want to do share. But do you ever put your debit card number, credit card number, or PAN number, or your passport number on a social media, or Twitter or Facebook? So we have issued a detailed FAQ just few days back, and we have said that in case of an Aadhaar, you know, Aadhaar has to be used very freely.
Mm.
You can give Aadhaar, your Aadhaar card to everyone.
Mm.
And you can rest assured that, you know, the nobody will be able to misuse your Aadhaar number, even if you know your Aadhaar number. Because Aadhaar number, if it is to be used for proving your identity, your fingerprint is required.
Mm.
Now, as we discussed just now, your face also will be required after some time, right? So it is. So your usage of Aadhaar number is not possible unless until it is accompanied by a fingerprint or OTP and face and iris and so and so. However, so far as the putting the Aadhaar number on the social media and other things are concerned, these are completely unnecessary.
And Aviation Minister Suresh Prabhu has directed DGCA today to submit a report on why as many as 9 A320neos have been grounded. Prabhu has stressed that the safety of the passengers is paramount and it cannot be compromised at any cost. Utkarsh Chaturvedi is joining us with more details on that. Utkarsh, what is the DGCA's response now to the Aviation Minister?
So Suresh Prabhu has asked a detailed report on the grounding of the A320neo engines. Now Suresh Prabhu, through the report, has asked the aviation regulator if there are any safety concerns in the current engines. Now given that the detailed report will take time, DGCA has sent the interim findings to the Ministry of Aviation. Now DGCA says that currently there are 60 A320neos which are flying in the Indian skies, and out of them 9 are currently grounded, 7 by IndiGo and 2 by Go Air. Now there two kind of A320neos, one with type B engines and the other with the type C engines. The ones which are with the type C engines do not have any technical snag, are fit to fly. But DGCA has assured the ministry that there is no safety concern at this point of time, as routine checkups are done to check if there are any technical issues in the aircraft. Now it was in March when DGCA has ordered 11 aircrafts to be grounded, 8 from IndiGo and 3 from Go Air, because they had developed technical glitches and were declared unfit to fly. Since then, IndiGo and Go Air have been able to decrease the number of aircrafts grounded to one each by Thursday. Now, even though the initial findings which DGCA has denied any safety concerns at this point of time, but a detailed report can have details which can be further detrimental to both Go Air and IndiGo. Now, IndiGo in a statement has said that the Pratt & Whitney has initiated the delivery of new engines and the changes are pre-planned according to the laid down norms.
Well, the deadline to resolve assets under the Reserve Bank's February 12 circular ends on August 27th. CNBC TV18 learns that at least 80 large accounts across banks will be impacted by this circular and are likely to end up in the bankruptcy court. Ritu Singh has some exclusive details on the story and she's joining us with more.
That's right, the clock is ticking and 27th August is the D-Day to watch out for. That is when the 180-day timeline given to bankers to resolve default accounts comes to an end, and several projects, as we understand, are likely to be impacted. In fact, at least 80 is what we've been able to assess will fall under this Feb 12 circular, and there is a 4 lakh crore rupee outstanding loan amount that is under the scanner as far as the Feb 12 circular is concerned. Power sector remains the most impacted sector. Remember that case is also being heard in the Allahabad High Court. Banks are, however, hopeful that before that deadline ends, at least a handful of cases, especially in the power sector, could possibly be resolved. That is, of course, something that very hopeful, and it remains to be seen whether or not that does happen before Monday. But across banks, you know, SBI and IDBI Bank are the ones with the largest number of such cases that might have to be sent to NCLT, followed by PNB and Axis Bank. The other corporate banks, including ICICI Bank, Bank of Baroda and Union Bank, are among some of the other banks that will get impacted. As far as the names of these individual companies are concerned, we've broken up the list into the power sector and the non-power sector. Power sector names include the likes of Jayaprakash Power, GMR, Chhattisgarh, SR Power, Mahan, Lanco, Amarkantak. There are about 36 to 38 of such cases that are likely to see this impact. The non-power sector names include the likes of Reliance Communication, Punch Lloyd, Gammon India, Bombay Rayon and Reliance Defence and Engineering. It is a fairly exhaustive list, but of course, as I said, you know, there could be additions or deletions to this depending on whether or not they're able to find resolution by the deadline.
Okay, that is one very important story to watch out for in terms of the power sector as well as the lenders as well. But let's move on. The Finland-based HMD Global that took the license to manufacture Nokia-branded smartphones made a global comeback in 2017 at the Mobile World Congress in Barcelona. And since then, the company has been on a launch spree. In fact, just in 2018 alone, the brand has 9 new devices, including the Nokia 6.1 Plus and 5.1 Plus that were released in the capital earlier this week. CNBC TV18's Megha Vishwanath caught up with Hugo Servikas, the chief product officer at HMD Global, and Ajay Mehta, country head, to know more about the brand's strategy going forward.
The Nokia 6 Plus and the Nokia 5 Plus feature a contemporary take on Nokia design. The first thing that you'll notice is that it's an all-screen design. But maybe the hallmark feature here is the performance. And maybe the most unique part of it is our unique take on Android. So these are pure, secure, and up-to-date. Latest innovation from Google, monthly security updates as a part of the Android One promise.
All right. So now, Ajay, we went over the top specs, and the last time I caught up with you, which was about 4 months back, you mentioned that India is number three globally for the brand.
We were among the top three.
Top three. Okay. Yes. Is there any shift there? Are we in the top two or probably the top market yet?
So we continue to be in the top three, Megha.
Okay.
We are amongst the top three in the world. All I can say is that we've really made a lot of progress since we last met. We've launched 9 new products, as you can see. The products have done better than what we expected it to. We've gone
What do you mean by that?
One area that we have really done well is from a marketing standpoint. You know, the preference, the intent, purchase intent, and the recommendation has gone up by double digits. We've gone even deeper with our offline channel. We've had some very strong partnerships with our online channel partners.
One thing that always intrigues me about smartphone brands, the strategy of rolling out one phone after the other with a few changes, like in terms of specification and almost being present in every price category. How do you ensure from a product point of view that you don't compete amongst your own portfolio?
Actually, if you look at our portfolio, we have a very focused and narrow portfolio, our claim.
Okay.
So Nokia One to Nokia 8 Sirocco. Now what we're doing here is that we're simply introducing an online offer. Also, I learned that 2/3 of the buyers are millennials.
Ajay, since you spoke about the millennials, now this is a market that almost everyone is going after, right? How are you then differentiating from what is available in the market, and what is, I would say, what is a Nokia USP?
Product philosophy that we have of quality and craftsmanship for the real life experiences that we are delivering, and for the pure Android story and Android One. I think these three pillars have worked very strongly in our favor.
So first of all, when you're buying online, you don't see the product. So you need to inherently trust the brand. Secondly, I think the most easy to understand reason to buy would be the best Android or Android One. So we will be among the first to roll out Android Pie. And then of course there's the factor around security, that with our monthly security updates, it's a very trusted product to use.
Welcome back. Well, India is a step closer to bringing back billionaire Vijay Mallya. Top CBS sources tell CNN News 18 that the investigative agency has submitted the video of Vijay Mallya's new home, which is barrack number 12 of Arthur Road Jail. After UK court's request, top CBI officials went to Mumbai last month. An additional chief home secretary of Maharashtra government coordinated the job of giving a jail a new look. Well, Onam, the 10-day harvest festival of the people of Kerala, is a dim affair in the cities and villages of the flood-hit state, with nearly 10 lakh flood-displaced people are still at the relief camps. This Onam, Kerala welcomes Mahabali by showing great fortitude in the face of adversity. On the day of Thiruvanam, Air Force makes a contribution of Rs 20 crores to the Chief Minister's Relief Fund in helping Kerala get back on its feet. Meanwhile, the Kerala relief aid controversy has taken a new twist. This after the UAE ambassador denied making any official announcement offering financial aid to Kerala. Remember, the news about UAE's aid was confirmed by the Kerala government on 21st of August. Okay, well, with good wishes for all the viewers this Onam, we wrap up this edition of Business Saturday. From the team and myself, thank you so much for watching. Do stay tuned to CNBC TV18 for all the news and updates.